The speaker is just wait.
So, it's a real pleasure to have with us Professor Carlos Duarte, who is also research professor at IBEA. Many of you already know Professor Duarte, but for those that don't know him, he graduated in biology from the University, Autonomous University of Madrid in 82. And he did a PhD on lignology in McGill University in Montreal in 1987. And then he has had several permanent visiting positions, one of them in Blanes, in the Institute for Advanced Studies in Blanes, and also and now at IMEDEA in Esporlas, and also he's the director of the International Laboratory for Global Change in collaboration between the CSIC and University. A university in Chile. the research, okay, in his webpage you can see some statements on the kind of research he is doing. So, Professor Duarte aims at providing scientific underpinnings for the effective conservation and sustainability of marine ecosystems through the identification of their role in the functioning of the biosphere, status, threats, responses to pressures, etc., and also the effects of global change on marine ecosystems. So this is the general framework in which the Professor Duarte's research is done. And he has done this studying a lot of variety of organisms from microbes to plants to the global ocean. And we are, several of us here are glad to have collaborated with him in several topics, including intersection point between physics and biology and network theory and biology. Apart from this, or as a result of this, all of this research does, he has published about 350 papers, and he's listed as one of the 250 top cited scientists by the ESI Institute of so they are in the citation index, and it's among the 25 most cited scientists in Spain in all the things. So his research is really doing a big impact. He has been awarded a lot of prizes. I want to cite two. In 2001, he was awarded the Hutchinson Prize from the Asgard American Society for Limnology and Oceanography. In 2007, he was awarded the Malaspina Prize, National Prize, given by the Spanish government in the field of natural resources. And so, this is why it's very nice and very important to have him with us. But now, the visit, the seminar today, the talk today is not about the many scientific things he can talk about. But he's here because he's also a member of the Scientific Council of the European Research Council. And so he will give us some explanations, some hints on what is the ERC and how to develop our ideas. So, stage is yours.
Thank you, Emilio, for the introduction. And I have two disclaimers to offer. One is that I changed glasses and I haven't accommodated yet, so I see this entirely out of focus, and you are all entirely out of focus, and I may be out of focus too, so my apologies for that. And the second one is that this is not an official seminar of the European Research Council. The European Research Council goes sometimes to different countries and different cities invited by the member states, and then they move like a little circus where they go through a series of talks encouraging participation from the scientists and raising awareness on the European Research Council. And for instance, last year we were invited to Spain during the Spanish presidency of the EU, and we held an information seminar in Santiago de Compostela. So, but it seems a bit awkward. I'm just a member of the UIB, and even though I'm going to Santiago de Compostela and other places and participating in this, we haven't really discussed the ERC internally. So this is not an official seminar of the ERC, but I think it's an opportunity to inform you of the European Research Council and encourage you to apply. I know that there are two applicants in the room already, so that's good news, but I hope that those of you who feel that meet the requirements of the program, then think about applying in the next call or considering this as a venue to fund your research. So I will have two parts of my presentation. First, I will discuss a little bit what the ERC is about and what type of research it funds, and also I will describe the mechanisms and the mechanics of applying and the evaluation process. And on the second part, I will give you some statistics on rates of success and who is being funded where and so on. And then we can have an exchange of views after this. So what the ERC is about is actually very much comprised within this motto, which is bringing great ideas to life, funding top researchers from anywhere in the world. So that basically is the ERC in a nutshell, because that's really what the ERC is designed to do. Perhaps it's not doing it already to the extent that we would like it to do, but it's certainly design and aim at achieving just that. So I'm going to use materials that are public on the web page. I'm not going to use any materials that I have access to because of my position in the Scientific Council. So everything that I will show is available on the web of the ERC or has been already shown to the public. For instance, I will be showing some slides that were presented in Santiago de Compostela last year. So there's nothing that I will say that is not accessible to anybody, just that I know that we are too busy, so most likely you haven't really browsed much through the website of the ERC, so I will make your life easier by showing you where the key aspects of the program are. And so the mission of the ERC is to manage and carry on the IDEAS program. You probably are aware of the framework programs through which the European Union funds joint research through the European Commission. We are now under FP7, which we learned, if I'm not mistaken, in 2013, and there's already discussions for the FP8 in place. And within the FP7, there was a new addition to the program that was an innovation for this program that is in place now, which was the IDEAS program. And up to now, most of the research that the framework program was funded was, let's say, collaborative research, in that you had to find a number of colleagues in a certain mixture of countries. At one point, you need to have partners from Southern European countries. Now you need to go and find them from Eastern European countries. But you need to have sort of the right mix of people, a little bit like in our standard jokes of we have a Spanish, a French, an Italian, a plane, things like that. So. And also the way the research was formulated was not through, let's say, a bottom-up approach, but it was rather through a top-down approach by which the work program that was published and was published every year with the calls will contain a relatively detailed description of the research that was called for. So you could, if you had an idea, you couldn't simply apply to the program to develop your idea. You have to match your idea with one of the topics that were increasingly detailed on the work program. So what the IDEAS program does is to go away from this model and then explore a model where the researcher, the individual researcher, is the actor. So these are individual grants, they are not collaborative grants, they are not team grants, they're just individual grants. So there's a single applicant that comes and doesn't have to meet a requirement that there should be a partner from one country or another. Anybody can apply from any country, even from outside the EU. The outside the EU, I will explain that there are certain requirements that need to be met, but any scientist in the world can apply to this program and can apply as a single applicant. You don't need to team up with other persons unless you need to do so to be able to succeed in your research. And the second element that was innovative in the idea scrum is that there was no predefined workaround, so the call was open to any topic that you would like to propose in any domain of science and social sciences, not just the natural sciences, but social sciences, technology. It can be applied, it can be basic, it can be anything. And there's no really disciplinary boundary. So interdisciplinary research is not only welcome, but is certainly encouraged. And therefore, there's no predefined topics or prescribed sort of research areas that are going to be funded. Any idea you may have has a place in the ERC if you're good enough and if your idea is innovative enough. So it's really about ideas and about excellence. That means that those are the real two requirements that need to be met. In the one hand, that the applicant meets criteria of excellence of the international standard. We can talk later about what this really boils down to in terms of where is the sort of the level by which this excellence is sort of evaluated. And the second is that you must have a great idea. And for instance, one of our grantees is one of the co-recipients of the Nobel Award in Physics for the graphene research, who's actually holding a grant doing this research under the ERC grant. So we find fun, great ideas by excellent researchers. And you can apply at any stage in your career. You must be a PhD, and you must have at least 2 years of experience after your PhD. But from then onwards, then you can apply at any time during your training as a scientist. Okay, then this sort of excellence in research is also defined a little bit like frontier research. The term frontier research was used to indicate that we, or the ERC and the DS program, is really looking forward for proposals that are exploring the limits of the research topic that you choose to address. So we encourage applicants to be innovative in their thinking, in the ideas they propose, take some risk, but the research should be doable. It cannot be just something that is a fantasy. It has to involve a lot of innovation, a groundbreaking idea, but it should also be something that is doable. It cannot be impossible, but we welcome the applicants to take some risk and are willing to also face the outcome of failure that may come from taking risk. And we continually strive to manage our panels to make sure that they do allow for risks in the evaluation process. So then the aims of the ERC are to support the best scientific efforts in Europe and across all fields of science, scholarship, and engineering. So anybody can apply that is committed to improve and advance knowledge. Then this is an investigator-driven and bottom-up research. So there's no prescribed research topics that are called for. Any research has a place in ERC in as long as you meet the criteria that I mentioned. And then we really encourage young scientists to apply. And in fact, the system is very much designed to endow the young applicants with independence. Because one of the big problems in Europe is that young postdocs are somehow always embedded within our research groups, and they have a hard time to develop an independent team. So there are elements in the rules of the process that are designed to allow young scientists to become independent scientists within the institution of choice. One of them, for instance, is that the applicant, the grant is given to the applicant, not to the institution. So the grant is portable. So if you want to move from, let's say you receive a grant from the EYB and you want to move to the University of Cantabria, the grant goes with you. And what this does is not only to build flexibility, but it also places you in a good position to negotiate with your institution, right? Because if your institution is not providing the resources or the environment that you need, then you might just find another institution that does provide for your needs, and that creates a little bit of competition in Europe for providing encouraging environments to attract ESG grantees. And as you will see in some of the slides, the country that is most succeeding at doing this is Switzerland, which is actually drawing ESG grantees from all other countries. In fact, there are very few Swiss nationals that are getting grants. Most of them are being funded to people from outside Switzerland, but they do provide an environment and matching funds and resources that make it very attractive for ESG grantees to move to Switzerland. So others need to sort of follow this model to be able to retain the best scientists in their institutions. Then the important thing is the quality of the idea and not the domain that you work on. So that's absolutely secondary. The important thing is your idea. Then it also tries to attract scientists from outside the EU. And in fact, there are some provisions that applicants that are coming from outside the EU can add significant amounts of money to their grants to cover the added cost of starting a lab from scratch when they move from outside the EU to an EU or a participant country. Okay, so the IDEAS program then was implemented through, it required that some structure be created. And the first thing that was put in place was the Scientific Council. And the Scientific Council is composed, I'm not sure how many members it has, but something around 14 members, which are scientists that have been recruited from an independent identification committee that has searched and recruited scientists from across Europe with levels of excellence. For instance, when I was recruited to the Scientific Council, which I was not a founding member, but I was recruited 2 years ago, then I was replacing, well, quotes replacing, one scientist who terminated his service ahead of time, which was Paul Crutzen, who, as you probably know, was a Nobel laureate in chemistry, working on environmental chemistry. There's several Nobel laureates sitting in the room. What the Scientific Council does really is to design the program, the goals of the program, and the mechanisms to run the IDEAS program. And then the ERC executive agency is the executive body that really implements the work program. So the main mandate of the Scientific Council is to set the policy of the ERC and also to establish the methodologies for applying and being funded, and also driving the strategy of the ERC. So basically, our most important job is to produce the work program. And the work program continues to be revised every year, and every year has new changes to improve the way in which the work program meets our goals. And then the European, the European Research Council Executive Agency then is an agency that was created within the Commission to implement the work program. So those are the people that manage the calls, that manage the grants, that manage the panels. But for instance, all panel members are identified and recruited by the Scientific Council. That's the ERC, they write the formal letters of appointment, but the search for suitable panel members is the responsibility of the Scientific Council. But we do that in very close collaboration between the Council and the agency. And right now, the director of the ERC Executive Agency is Pablo Amor, who is a Spaniard but has been working in the Commission for many years. And he's director at Interim. So there's now a process open for an open call for a new director for the ERC Executive Agency. And then, in addition to the ERC Executive Agency, the Scientific Council has also a board, a president, and three vice presidents, which constitute the board. And the board works very closely with the ERC and meets regularly to manage and monitor the entire program. The ERC Executive Agency, which you will see as ERCIA, has now about 350 staff members, and most of these staff members are within the unit that is responsible for evaluation, and those are not, let's say, administrative personnel. They are scientists, colleagues, all of them hold PhDs and they have conducted excellent research themselves, but they are now acting as coordinators of the panels and running the panels and the evaluation process through the mechanisms put in place and defined by the work program. And the building is located in very near the North Station in Brussels, if you know a little bit your bearings in Brussels. So it's located in the Covent Garden building, and it has, I think, four floors. The top four floors of the building are the premises of the RCL. And this is the structure of the executive agency. So Paula Moore is the interim director, and then there are four units that support the director, and then there are three additional units. There's one on communications, there's one on scientific management, and you can really see the photo there. But the new director is José Manuel Labastida, who was director of the research at the National Plan in Spain until maybe a month and a half ago. He was recruited to the ERC, to the SIA, and he started in February 16th. So see, he's the newest addition to this group photo there. Then there's a unit that is in charge of the grant management, and then another one that is in charge of resources and support. And for instance, there is a legal department and a whole bunch of units that take care of this. Basically, this arm here is taking care of the evaluation process, and this arm here is taking care of the management of the grants, and this team here is taking care of the tools through which the ERC operates, and also the communications, and also the legal department and the legal issues that involve the ERC. Now we get to the flesh of which I suppose you're most interested, which is the types of grants and the requirements to be funded. So there are really two types of grants in the ERC. There is a type of grant called starting grants, and those are for the best researchers with 12 years of experience after the PhD. So anybody that has had a PhD title for 2 years can already apply. It goes all the way to 12 years after your PhD. And there are two tiers within this. There's starters, which are applicants that they have worked for 2 to 6 years after their PhD, and then consolidators, who are applicants that have worked from 7 to 12 years after their PhD. And this was an addition on last year's work program, and the reason why this additional split within the starting grants was added is that, of course, we observed that there was a tendency of the age of the applicants to be higher towards the end of the 10 year block. And by having these two streamlines of starters and consolidators, now on the last year call, which was the first one where this was implemented, we already observed that the age structure is very even. So now with this two tier structure, now anybody with 2 to 3 years after PhD has basically the same likelihood of being funded than somebody who has been working as a postdoc for already 10 years. So now it's far more even, and it's not just a matter of those who have accumulated more time and merits being more likely to be funded. Then these time windows for the two tiers of the starting grants have also provisions that they can be expanded if, for instance, somebody has been sick on a sick leave for a long term, or for parental leaves for either fathers or mothers, or if you have had career breaks, or for instance, if you've served in the military or things like that. So you can make a case that your career had a break of whatever time, and then your time window is then extended to accommodate for that. And in terms of the parental things, then it's 1 year per child, right? So if you had one child, then you can extend your window by 1 year. And the grants are up to 2 million euros, and they are the same amount whether you apply to the starters or the consolidators. And in fact, most grants are 1.5 million euros, but if the applicant comes from outside the EU, then this applicant can add an additional 500,000 euros to the grant on the cost of establishing a research team in Europe. And then the second type of grants are called advanced grants, and those are for top research leaders who are already very well established in their fields, and they must have at least 10 years of experience. So that means that if you've worked after your PhD for 11 years, you can either choose to apply here or you can apply there, right? And then you must also demonstrate significant research achievements. And we can then discuss by examples what significant research achievements really boil down to be. And the maximum size of the grants are 3.5 million euros. And this maximum size of the grant, most grants will be 3 million euros. But again, there are two types of grants that do allow for an additional half a million euros, which are, again, if you come from outside the EU to work in Europe, then you can add half a million euros to your grant. And also, if your grant involves very heavy equipment or something that is very unique, then you can also make a case and add 500,000 euros. Or also, if your grant is of an interdisciplinary nature that requires more than two teams, or, well, two PIs, two co-PIs to come together to achieve the goals, then you can also add half a million euro in addition. Okay, and the requirements to be funded are the first one is excellence. So if you don't meet this one, then there's really no point in you applying because you will not succeed. And this is evaluated through your 10-year track record. So for instance, in my case, if I was an applicant, I would, the panel, the evaluators and myself, will be only required to submit my achievements during the last 10 years. So if I receive a Nobel Award 11 years ago, that's irrelevant. That's outside the window, right? So it's only 10-year track windows, and then this sort of a little bit discounts for the accumulated merits. So 10 years are sort of a fair amount of track record. And then the evidence of excellence that is evaluated are, of course, the contents and achievements in terms of the particular discoveries, but also we use common metrics such as publications in international journals, the citations that your work has received, things like the H index are usually reported, but they don't go into an equation to grant. People are just granted on the basis of the evaluation of their overall merits. And then the number of grants you have had, and also any sort of recognitions or honors that you have received, also provide evidence, independent evidence of excellence. And in fact, the applicants are asked to write a 5-page document where you provide your self-assessment of excellence and provide these indicators on a narrative account of why you feel that your research has achieved excellence. And then you must also have a brilliant idea. This should be somewhat risky, but it should be doable. So that's a delicate balance that you can maybe propose something that is really fantastic and extraordinary, but when the panel reads it, there's really no evidence that this can be done. So somehow when you write your proposal, besides the brilliant idea, you should also add some elements that indicate that this idea is not entirely crazy and it can actually be done. And the brilliant idea is developed on, I think, a maximum of 10 pages. So the proposals are relatively small. There's 15-page proposals. And I will go through the evaluation process later, so you don't have to write 150-page documents, which is sort of almost the average size for the collaboration program. They're very large proposals. These are 15-page proposals, and they go to the nuts and bolts of your research and your own merits. And then if the scientist is applying from outside the EU, then anybody can apply from any country, but the applicant must have at least a part-time appointment, and that's a 50% appointment with an institution based on the EU or a partner country. Because in addition to EU members, then countries like Israel, Switzerland, Norway, which are not EU members, but they participate in the framework program, they also participate. in the VS product. And also, you must be prepared to allocate at least 30% of your time to developing this grant, okay, to working in the grant. So that those are your commitments. I will walk you then through the evaluation process. And as I said earlier, these are the slides that were presented by Alejandro Martin Hobdi, who's one of the persons that runs the evaluation department. In particular, he's in charge of the starting grants. Then he presented this in Santiago last year. But basically, these are really up to date on the processes, although they might change for 2012 a little bit. So there's only a single submission. So you go to the webpage of the ERC and you submit in one stage, even though the evaluation is run in two steps. And I will go into what is evaluated in which one of these steps. And then the submission is electronic via this EPSS tool of the firmware program. And the deadlines are strictly enforced, and no justifications of tardiness are allowed. So if you do not submit by deadline, then whether the system was down or the power failing your home and so on, it cannot be evaluated. And then the proposal has two parts. One is part A, which is administrative, and that's, I think, is 3 pages. And the part B is the scientific proposal, which include your 5 pages of self-declared or self-evaluated excellence and the 10-page proposal. So in total, it's 18 pages, but this administrative forms include just information of where you are located, which is your host institution, the addresses, and things like that, very simple. And the submission is to panels. And I can then maybe... So the way the evaluation is conducted is that the ERC has divided operationally all research topics into 25 panels. And I will show you the structure of the panels, which I think is useful. Which is somewhere to begin on this. Okay. So this is just operational. It doesn't mean that there are boundaries, and we know that there are many proposals that can go across panels. And in fact, these panels do not really mean disciplines, because some of them are really very interdisciplinary themselves. But this is just operational in terms of how the evaluation is conducted. So there are 3 domains, which are life sciences, social sciences and humanities, and physical sciences and engineering. And you will find that there are overlaps and some redundancies between these, and they only mean that you can choose maybe sometimes more than one panel to apply and to file your application to. So the life sciences have 9 panels, and they cover all aspects of life sciences. And for instance, here they go into environmental biology, which may be linked to air system science, and maybe linked to environment and society, which are things that have to do with sustainability and global change and things like that. So, for instance, in my case, if I was to file a research proposal myself, I'd probably have to consider whether I submit here, here, or there. And that's your own call. You can, for instance, the ERC publishes the outcome of the call, so you can look at the grants that have been managed, although it doesn't say which fund they funded each grant. So this is really your call. And you can identify a primary panel and a secondary one if you think that your proposal can be evaluated by more than one panel. But the ERC does not interfere with your choice. So if you make the wrong choice, that's your problem. Because if we take your proposal, or the ERC takes your proposal and then reallocates to a panel, that opens up for a complaint from your side if your proposal is not selected. So you look at the panels, think about them, and consider which one will fit better your proposal.
Excuse me, is the composition of the panels public?
No, what is public is who's the chair of the panels. But I think that is published every year after the call, so you can see who chair the panel. But the composition is not public, also because in addition to the panel members themselves, there's probably 4 times as many people who have been involved in evaluation as remote members. And each panel has around 12 to 14 members. And then we have 2 sets of panels for each panel. So We have this panel structure for advanced grants, and we have a similar panel structure for starting grants. And then for each of advanced grants and starting grants, one panel serves in odd years and the other one serves in even years. So for instance, if you have your proposal submitted and rejected 1 year, and you can reapply, and you want to reapply, if you reapply next year, then it will not be seen by the same evaluators. So it is seen by sort of fresh eyes, and there's no memory of the discussions earlier, because you may actually have addressed many of the problems, right? So this, in total, then this 25 panel structure is multiplied by four, right? One for starting grants, one for advanced grants, and one for each odd years and even years.
So in the panels, the panels are interdisciplinary. For example, there are any physicists in some of the social sciences and the life sciences, or they are really separated?
Well, I think that it would be odd that if you have something called, for instance, individual institutional markets, this panel, the people that are populated in this panel within the scientific council, they think that out of the 12 members, one needs to be a physicist, right? Because most of the contributions to this topic don't come from physicists.
Yeah,
so,
but on the one hand, you are asking for projects that we'll discuss.
Yes, if you wait a little bit, we get to how interdisciplinary proposals are handled, right?
Obviously.
Yes. And you will never have a panel that's going to have all possible cases represented there. So the panels have descriptors that you can read. So if you go to the webpage, there are descriptors of the panels in the call for applicants. In the guide for applicants, there are descriptors that are maybe 50, 60 keywords for each panel that describe a little bit the domain of topics that are being addressed by each panel. And we can possibly have panel members that each match one of these keywords, right? We only have 12 to 14 panel members. So I think that you will find if we have this group replicated 10 times, then you will have persons in the floor that will make a recommendation for somebody who's missing from the panel to be added. But this is really not practical. But I will discuss how in fact, the word interdisciplinary is not really appropriate in this context. We really refer to cross-panel proposals, because they can be interdisciplinary proposals that can be really evaluated fully within one panel, but they can be proposals that require expertise that are scattered in different panels, and in that case, then we call both panels to work together to evaluate the proposal.
Well, also, in line with complex systems, missions, in a sense, since we are here in FISC, we are, of course, interested in complex systems.
Yes, yeah. More complex systems, they're found everywhere, right? Yes, we can have complex systems anywhere, and in fact, this has moved. It would be very difficult to have one topic that is called complex systems, or one topic that is called your panel, right? You go to many institutes, and there's a panel for this institute and that institute, but I can guarantee you that many of the proposals that are funded are really proposals on complex system dynamics, and I know some of them. So if you go and look at go on the web and look at the proposals that are funded, any reservations you may have that interdisciplinary proposals are not really addressed or that complex systems are not included will be just dissipated if you take a look at what is being funded. So the important thing is not what the name of the panel is that if you submit a proposal that doesn't fit into any one panel, then of course you have to submit to one panel here, which addresses the primary goal of your proposal. But for instance, if you were submitting something on phylogenetic trees and a complex system approach to phylogenetic trees, you would not be submitted to condensed matter physics, although maybe that's where it belongs. Or Maxi, you're a main professor of this, right? So it will probably be sent to here, LSA, right? And then if the panel then feels that there's some expertise needed on a network analysis or something that has to be brought in to evaluate this, then there's a dialogue between the relevant panels. And you also engage experts already in the first step from outside the panel to provide expertise on this topic. So and you can also identify a secondary panel that you want to submit. So that's really addressed operationally. But you might pose questions as to things that may not work, but I will challenge you to come with a solution that fits all possible cases. Just that doesn't exist. So it has to be operational. Okay, so these are the 25 panels. Then on the these are handling the proposal through the entire life stage in the process. Right? In the first stage, the proposal, but then I go back to this. Okay. So we only switch proposals between panels when there's a clear mistake by the applicant and also in dialogue with the applicant, but in my experience this is never done. I actually serve as chair of one of the panels, let us say on evolutionary and population biology, and so I've done also the part of running the panel and evaluating and issuing to the scientific council one, and we never switched one proposal from one panel to another. We might invite members from other panels to provide input on and evaluate the proposal, but we never really threw it away to another proposal. And then this we have discussed already. So these are the components, which we have. This is a little bit of a breakdown of the 15-page things. So this is section one, which is evaluated in the first stage, which includes a scientific leadership profile of 2 pages, a CV including the funding history for 2 pages, 10-year track record, and then extended synopsis of the project, which is 5 pages. And then the panel only has access to this part of the proposal in the first stage. And these are fully evaluated within the panel. And then the panel then selects roughly about a third of the proposals for further evaluation. And then those proposals go to the second step. And in a second step, then you have access to the full scientific proposals, which is 15 pages, and then a very short document which describes the research environment and what your institution is going to provide to make the research doable. And then where appropriate, there can be some information on ethics, for instance, if you work with animals or if your research may have military applications, so there's some that they do have. Then you also need a letter from your host institution saying that they're willing to host you in case your application succeeds, a copy of your PhD, and then if you claim that your window of eligibility needs to be expanded because of parental leaves or career breaks and so on, then you should provide some documentation that supports your statement. And then these are the two criteria, and then the proposals are ranked for the quality of the principal investigator and the quality of the research projects, and there are thresholds that if any proposal falls below the threshold in any of these two criteria, then it's not eligible. And proposals that fall below the thresholds, then they cannot be resubmitted next year. The applicant will have to wait at least 1 more year to be able to reapply, right? Because it means that you really need to do a lot of improvement either to your CV or your ideas. And in the step two, then all the evaluations that have been retained, then they come to step two, and in the step two, they are evaluated by remote referees. We try to engage at least 3 remote referees, which are real experts on the specific topic that you address. But sometimes it is difficult to recruit that many, so I think the mean is about 2 referees, external referees per proposal. And in the case of the starting grants, the step two includes an interview with the applicants. So the applicants that go to step two on a starting grant, then they're called to Brussels and they're interviewed by the panel for about 30 minutes. Yeah, so this is sort of the life history of how this is managed, but we have already reviewed this. And then here there is a provision that up to this year, this may change in the future, then proposals that were labeled interdisciplinary, then they were brought to a final meeting where all panel chairs were discussing together. And then there was a reservation of, I think it was 10% of the budget was reserved to fund these proposals. But really the instructions to the panels are if they can assess the proposal within a panel, then they should decide on whether it should be funded or not. And if they do need clearly input from other panels and discuss this with other panels, then they should bring it to this final panel panel chair meeting, and then try to get the proposal funded from this 10% for interdisciplinary proposals. We have discussed this already. The budget for interdisciplinary was actually 13% of the total budget was reserved there, but the number of interdisciplinary proposals that were funded was more than 30%, because then some of them were already funded within the panels.
Are there some predefined keys? How many proposals would be granted for each panel, or is this purely a scientific?
The rule that is followed is that the proposals are then first assigned to panels, and then each panel is allowed a percent of the budget that sort of accommodates the number of proposals they have received. And there's a little bit of a pre-arranged distribution between domains. And then within domains, then a panel that has 20% of the proposals then will be able to allocate 20% of the funding, right? So we give no priority to one panel, just is really driven by demand from the applicants. Well, and also here, a note is that the panels are instructed not to enter into the details of the budget, unless there's something that is awfully wrong. Then panels are asked not, for instance, comment or do budgetary reductions. For instance, if the salary of the scientist seems to be too high or something like that, if the institution that is hosting the scientists allow them to charge 1 million euros for salary for a year, then that's fine. So panels are not instructed not to micromanage and not to do cuts unless there's some obvious mistake or something that is obviously wrong. So most proposals actually are funded for the full amount that is applied for, which is also different from other application programs. And the negotiation involves non-negotiation. So once there's an offer from the RCA to the applicant, then you either take it or leave it. But we do not negotiate whether you want need 100,000 more or something like that. So it's a closed proposal, but as I say, then most of the proposals do not have any budgetary reduction by the time they are selected. And then we really look for balance in the panels, and there's very strict rules of conduct, including very strict rules for conflicts of interest, which are sometimes problematic, because really what happens is that there's a proposal in the floor that includes your institution, then you're excluded from the discussion. You have to leave the room, you do not participate at all in the discussion. And for instance, for very large organizations like CNRS or FESIC, then that means that you actually are outside of the room a lot. And it really interferes with the functionality of the panels. I told you that there's been complaints and arguments, but we have really not found a very good solution that at the same time preserves the principle of no conflicts of interest. For example, in my case, I would have to leave the room either any proposal that includes the SIC or includes UND. So it's a lot of time out of the room. And then the panel chairs can serve for a maximum of 3 terms, and the panel members can serve for a maximum of 4 terms. So we also have a rotation in the panels, and that rotation has already been initiated, so it's not always the same group of people who are evaluating the proposals. In fact, we have a larger rotation than that, because sometimes panel members have conflicts with dates or they're away or something. So typically we have to rotate 4 members every year out of a panel of 12. So a third of the panel is really rotated every year. And I think that's about all that you need to know about this. And then I will show you some statistics And with this, then we can have a discussion because it's already been too long. So I'll show you some statistics first of starting grants. And those are the statistics for the 2010 call, which are the last that are published on the web. So this PDF presentation is actually available in the web to anybody. So the number of proposals submitted were about 3,000 proposals submitted to the ERC. There were about 35% to life sciences, 42% to physical sciences, and 22% to social sciences. And the budget allocated to each of those domains were roughly about that much. And then out of those, 153 were selected, 195 out of these, and 79 out of 639. So a total of 427 proposals, and the success rate is 15%, which is about maybe a third of the success rate in the Plan Nacional in Spain. Maybe from half to a third. So it's very competitive, but once you get funded, then you really get a lot of resources for 5 years. And I was going to mention something more about the success rate of 50%. Yes, and we, the IDEAS program had a very clever provision for a stepwise implementation. So the budget of the IDEAS program has been increasing by 25% per year. So by next year, the funding is already double relative to the first call. And I believe that the call next year, 2012, will allocate something like 1.8 billion euros to the IDEAS program. So it's a significant amount of resources. And it's growing every year, but the success rate remains about 30 to 15%. So the first year there was a flood of proposals, mostly from Italy, and there was some scare that the system was not really scaled for this flood of proposals, but then it went quickly down, and now has increased again. Not to the level of the first year, but it has increased a little bit. But the success rate has remained very much around 13 to 15%. So it seems like some strong players didn't apply on the first year. They were holding and waiting to see how the system worked and so on, and they are applying through the process. So it's not like the first year there were all the strong candidates and then the system has become less competitive. It is just as competitive as it was on the first year.
Yeah, in the moment that you are saying the funds of the different areas, are you taking into account how many of the proposals have passed the first filter or just the raw number of applications?
The raw number of applications. In fact, the number of proposals are that go through the first filter are already scaled up because the panels are instructed, they are given, they are allowed to pass enough proposals to the second step to make, I think, something like three times the budget they have allocated, right? Mm-hmm. And the budget they are allocated is roughly also scaled to the proposals they receive. So both things are connected.
No, because this can be, I mean, for instance, what you were saying about Italy, I know about that, and what happens after the institutions encourage, force the people that want them to apply, no?
Yeah.
So you can have fields that do that to the people that work in that area, and then you will have areas with much more proposals than the...
Yeah, well, we'll see some numbers on actual number of proposals. And in social sciences, there are a little bit fewer proposals. But across the other panels, we're talking about maybe 100 proposals per panel, plus or minus 20%. And there is no panel that consistently receives very few proposals. So that is not that much of a problem, really. And this is the success rate, or well, not the rate, but the percent, the distribution of grants per countries. These, the colors are the different domains. And then Spain sits at about maybe number 7 in number of starting grants across the 21 countries that participate. Because you will see that, for instance, this is Switzerland, which is number 4, and Israel is number 4. So these are not EU countries, but they participate very strongly. In fact, there's something funny, but I think there's some statistics on this. But because I'm the scientific council has different groups and committees, and I'm a member of the committee on panels that is responsible for how the panels work and populating the panels and so on. And I'm also a member of the gender equality working group. And we just released a gender equality action plan, an strategic plan that is available on the web, and was a press release in Science two weeks ago about our plan. But then, so I will show some statistics on gender, which of course we have a lot to improve, but this is just the landscape in Europe. It's not that we can really fix the problem. But if we were to look at the female applicants, then Spain would probably be number 4, not number 7. So our females are doing much better than we are doing on adults as a whole.
Is there a reason for the big gap between the first three countries and the others?
The reason is that they file a lot of proposals. So in fact, if you, instead of looking at the bulk number of grants, you look at the success rate, that means the proportion of proposals submitted that are funded, then this landscape changes a lot. And there are some countries that move forward and some backward, but this big difference is not really driven by a very large success rate of these three countries, but really because they also produce a lot of applications. And in fact, Max Planck, I think, is participating massively in the process. So these are sort of the numbers, and Spain received last year about 23 starting grants, and then it's number 7, and I think it's doing a bit less well in the advanced grants. And this is about...
That was only from the start.
Sorry? This is starting grants only. Yes. And then this is males and females. Well, Spain is the same, more or less, should be the same numbers that we're looking at, but this is by nationality of the applicant, not of the institution. So here you don't see Switzerland, right? Because Swiss, I don't know, CH, is here, right? But if you look at applicants going to Switzerland, then it's number 4, right? Because most of the applicants going to Switzerland come from outside Switzerland. If you look at these are the female applicants. So Spain will be tied with the Netherlands and Israel in number 4 place, sorry, number 5 place in female applicants. But basically, there's something like I think around 20% of applicants, grantees are females, but there's something like 17% applicants are females. So there's really, we monitor very closely the panel behavior for evidence of discrimination, but in fact, there's a little bit higher percentage of females granted than applicants. And then this is the same statistics by the country of residence of the Switzerland appears already closer up here. And this is an interesting slide that shows how many of the grantees were moving to the country, staying in the country, and they were non-European nationals, and they were from other European nationals, or countries that were staying within their country of origin. So these red are the ones that are moving from outside the EU, right? And the system really aims at attracting the best scientists from anywhere in the world, and we are not doing very well on that. We need to attract more people from outside the EU to come. But most people, for instance, in France or Germany are actually Germans or French that are applying to French, these bars. But if you look at Switzerland, then the majority are other European nationals that moving to France, moving to Switzerland to do their research in Switzerland. That's because they now offer a lot of benefits to people that are moving there with an ERC grant. So they have made it very attractive for grantees to move to Switzerland to do their research in Switzerland. These are statistics per panel. So here you see the number of proposals that each panel funded. So some differences between panels, but there are about 15 to 70 proposals on average. Some of them receive more, but this changes from year to year. And these are the social sciences, which have a little bit less volume of applications. And the stripe bars are the female applicants in the different domains. And overall, 26%. Awards go to women, and I think there's only about 17% applicants. So they're doing well. And I can show you similar statistics for advanced if you want, but if your board is too late already, I can stop here. So here the success rate for the advanced grants was a bit less. For starting grants was 15%. For advanced grants is 13%. So from 2,000 to 266 proposals retained, with about similar percentages across domains. And this is the distribution by country, which is similar to the previous one. The UK, Germany, and France taking most of the proposals, and then Switzerland and Italy doing very well. Israel does very well on starting grants, but not so much in advanced grants. And Spain here is number 7 again. This is in terms of nationality. And here you see some stripes with the gender. And here we're doing very poorly in terms of female applicants. But there are also not that many females in the more than 10 years after PhD domain, at least looking at the room. Not that many here. Yes. This is by the country of residence. So similar statistics to what we've seen before. The country of the host institutions, and you can see that here there is far less mobility in the advanced grants than there is on the starting grants. So in the starting grants there's more people moving across countries and across institutions than in the advanced grants, but that's maybe only natural. And these are again the number of proposals funded across panels. And here, instead of 26.5% females, there's only 9% females, but the number of female applicants is very low in advanced grants. And in terms of Spain, well, these figures do not show success rate. They also tell you the percent distribution by countries. But if you look at success rate, Spain does very well in the starting grants. We do better than the average on starting grants, but we don't do as well in advanced grants. And also because there are very few applications for advanced grants. So, for some reason, Spanish scientists are not, either they do not know the system, they don't think they're good enough, or they just ignore it. But there are not enough applications from Spain, provided its weight in the research landscape in Europe. And that's all I have to, there are more statistics, but they are all contained in this booklet. Those contain the 2009 statistics, and the 2010 you can get from the web page. This all comes from the web page. So thank you, and then we can move to an informal discussion.
So, questions, comments?